He used to say all of the time that the things of God will never fall on you like ripe cherries off a tree, like apples that fall off of a tree when it's harvest time. The things of God won't just come on you. How many of you ever have said or heard people say, don't lift your hand, it's rhetorical. You've heard people say, oh, well, whatever God wants for me will happen. How many of you heard that? Maybe even said it. I think I've even said it a time or two. Well, I have news for you. That statement is not true. How many of you know that God does not get what he wants all of the time? The scripture says that he desires that all men come to repentance. Has all men come to repentance? Are there people dying and going to hell all of the time? So what does that tell you? God doesn't get what he wants all the time. And it's the same thing for us. If we are fashioned and likened in his image, created in his image and in likeness, then it's the same way for us. We don't get what we want all of the time unless there's a purpose, there is a pursuit, there is corresponding action that causes it to come to pass. And this weekend, tonight, we're going to talk about that. And this weekend as well, we're going to go after it. I mean, when I thought of, I'll share this tomorrow when I introduce Kelly, when I thought of just who of a better person to teach faith. Her father, Kenneth Copeland, is my spiritual father, and he taught me faith. Paul said in the New Testament, he said, you have many teachers, but you have not many fathers. You have not many people that have birthed you. And he said to them, he said, I birthed you. And he said, I'm the one that travailed in labor for you. And I'm so thankful to God for Brother Kenneth Copeland because he was that for me. And his daughter, Kelly, the Lord has used her to be a blessing in my life. And their family, I don't know of another family personally, literally, that's walking on this earth that knows how to walk by faith more than them. And they get criticized for it. But they're the ones that are living it and are sure enough living a great life. And I can tell you that I've exercised these same principles in the Word of God, and I'm living a great life because of it. And I want to encourage you that you can have the same thing. And it's not even about like, oh, this, you know, fame. People think one thing when you become famous too as well. I learned that. People think you always have a lot of money to give them, which is not true. You always have money, but you don't have a lot of money to just give out. Some of y'all ain't receiving that, but that's okay. If you ever get to that place, you'll know what I'm talking about. When you have people that aren't even, you've never even heard of, say they're your cousins, and they're calling you. Calling you out the, hey, I'm your cousin. Oh, you are? Oh, I didn't know you. Somebody did that to me, bless their heart. I asked my mom, I said, who is this? She said, oh, that's your cousin. I said, I don't know who he is. And she said, well, you wouldn't because he's never around. Well, I don't know why he's contacting me outside of, you know, thank God for some new fame and things like that, new notoriety. And it comes with the price. You have to learn how to tell people no and all that good stuff. But anyway, that's not my message tonight. But all of that to say, it comes with a responsibility. And the scripture even says that the hundredfold comes with what? Persecution. You're talking about believing God for things? Things is one thing. Oh, my goodness. Why do you have to believe God for ministry things or money to go around the world? I remember when we were getting ready to set out to go to Europe this past summer, we didn't have nothing. Zilch. Zero. But did that stop the plan of God for us? Did we go? Did we go to every single place that we said the Lord told us to go? Did we do everything that he told us to do? Absolutely. How was that able to happen with no money in the bank? Ooh. Oh, I'm getting excited tonight, man. It's almost like unlocking a secret. I see for some of you, some things you may have heard tonight before or this weekend, you may have heard before. And then there are certain things that you may not have ever heard before. I was reading some things and I was studying my time with the Lord to prepare for this, and I was seeing things from a new perspective concerning faith. And I never thought I'd be one of those people that would preach out of Mark 11, but I guess I am tonight. Praise the Lord. So tonight I want to just encourage you guys to stay focused. Let's turn to Mark 11.
It's the faith chapter. Praise the Lord. Brother Hagin used to teach on this all of the time. If not in every meeting, he preached on it at least at some point in the meeting. How many of you ever heard of Brother Kenneth E. Hagin? Praise the Lord. Maybe we'll show a little video of him. He was a spiritual father to many people, such as, you know, Kenneth Copeland, and some of the great giants of faith that we consider even now. He's been a blessing and a mentor to them, and even to me. He's gone home to be with Jesus, but he moved in signs and wonders. I tell you, anybody ever either been into a Kenneth Hagin meeting or seen him when the Spirit starts moving? One video, just go on YouTube, they call it the night the Holy Ghost gets the moving. And they had 170-something chairs break from people just getting in God. Oh, man, and you talking about crazy. Woo, I've never seen anything like it. But you could tell it was the Lord, first of all, because the Scripture says the things of the Spirit do what? Produce life and peace. And all you could sense and all you could feel is the peace of God. And for that, I am forever grateful to God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Mark 11. Before I share that, I want to share one thing that the Lord showed me. And I felt like this is a precedence for the weekend. Remember I said that faith requires corresponding action. On something on our part has to be done. And in this, just turn to 2 Timothy 3. This isn't in my original notes, but I felt impressed of the Lord to share this with you guys tonight as well. 2 Timothy chapter 3. I'm just going to read it for the sake of time. It says, "This now also, that in the last days perilous times shall come." Are we in the last days? So the qualification of a last day, seeing it, is what? Perilous times. What are the perilous times? "Men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy." Sounds like some of the things that's going on now, right? "Without natural affection." Oh boy, do we see that now. "Truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good." Do we ever see that with ISIS? "Traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God." And one time the Lord, I was reading this, and the Lord told me, he said, he was convicting me about something, and I thought it was something small. Wasn't, you know, a big deal. And when he took me to the Scripture, he said, "Do you realize that you are yielding to a sign of the time?" And did I change? I said, "Whoa, I'm yielding to perilous times by doing what I was doing." So if you find yourself doing anything in this list, I'd encourage you to change. Because it says what the end result is. Keep going down. "They have a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof. From such do what? Turn away." I love this. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with diverse lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. And he goes on to say just different things about different people just about what the benefit of or what the result, what happens as a result of this yielding to perilous times. And one translation says that, where it says they're ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth, one translation, it actually says that it eventually shipwrecks their faith. We're in a faith school. And tonight when, again, I was preparing for this and the Lord put the Scripture in my heart, he said, before you even start talking about what you believe in God for, get the sin dealt with. Because if you are yielding to any type of sin that is involved in this perilous times, it will eventually shipwreck your faith. Are you hearing me tonight? I don't know. Ever since I came back from Toronto, I'm a little bold. They prophesied that to me. They said, "Oh, you're going to," they said, "you thought you were bold before." They said, "You're going to be on a whole nother level." And I'm like, "Me? What?" But I feel it tonight. It's in me.
But when you deal with the sin, you deal with the issue that's blocking the faith from working to manifest what God is wanting to give you. So if there's anything in your life, if you see any example of this in your life right now, I want you to confess it, ask the Lord to forgive you, receive his love. Go ahead, confess it. You don't have to confess it out loud because, well, I sure enough don't want to hear it. Let him hear it to his ears. Praise God. Confess it. Receive the blood of Jesus for it. And never do it again. Simple. That's what true repentance is. I can't remember who posted this. Excuse me. They said repentance is not an apology. Repentance means to turn away from it and to never go back to it. So tonight, don't let your faith be shipwrecked. Because, again, God has some things that he wants to do in you and through you to show the world who he actually is. And we are going to make sure that he does it. Amen? Praise the Lord. So, again, let's just go back to Mark 11. Mark 11. When you have it, say amen. If you don't have a Bible, just share with someone, or I believe we'll have the scriptures up on the screen, right, Anna? Just give me a thumbs up or thumb down if we're going to have the scriptures. We will. Mark 11. Okay, Mark chapter 11, and let's start at verse 1. It says, when they came nigh to Jerusalem, unto Bethage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sendeth forth two of his disciples and saith unto them, go your way into the village over against you. And soon as you entered into it, you shall find the colt tied whereon never man sat. Loose him and bring him. And if any man say unto you, who do you this? Say that the Lord hath need of him, and straightway he will send him hither. And I love this because Jesus told them, this is really the word of wisdom in operation. He gave them the word of wisdom. It was a thought or a plan in the mind of God concerning the plan of God that he needed this donkey for something, right? Or he needed this animal, this colt for something, right? And he told them, if you're stopped, tell them the Lord has need of it. And how many of you know he wasn't talking about himself? The Lord showed me that today. He's like, he wasn't talking about him. I had need of it. And therefore, I told Jesus to say that me, the Lord, had need of it. We're going to keep on going. Verse 4, and there went they and found the colt tied by the door without in a place where two ways meet, and they loosed him. And you can keep reading. It says that, you know, they found him, and the person said, you know, what are you doing with it? And Jesus, they did as Jesus commanded them. They said that the Lord has needs of it. And what happened? They let him go. So the word of wisdom that Jesus had given to his disciples did what? Came to pass. Let's keep on reading. Go down to verse 13. It says, and seeing a fig tree afar off, having leaves, this was in the next day, in the morning, Jesus came, if happily he might find anything upon it. And where he came unto it, he found nothing but leaves. Oh, somebody say, nothing but leaves. For the time of figs was not yet. And Jesus answered and said unto it. I love this. Look at this. In response, Jesus said to it. He spoke back to the tree. I'll never forget Jesse DePlanis said this. He said, so the tree must have said something. What was it saying? Lack. I don't have the fruit to give you. And what did Jesus do? He spoke to the lack. He cursed it. Right? Keep on reading. And Jesus answered and said, no man eat fruit of thee hereafter forever. And his disciples heard it. Skip down to verse 20. And in the morning, again, as they passed by, the disciples saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. And Peter, calling to remembrance, saith unto him, Master, behold, the fig tree which thou cursed is withered away. Somebody say, withered away. So that tells you what happened. What Jesus said came to pass, right? What he spoke came to pass. And Jesus answering them said unto them what? Have faith in God. Everybody say that. Have faith in God. For verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall what? Have whatsoever he says. Woo. Oh, man. Nothing excites me more than talking about faith. I love this. He shall have whatsoever he saith. Verse 24, therefore I say unto you, whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall what? Have them. So, what is the whole thing about this? Jesus, we see, spoke to the fig tree. And what happened to the fig tree? He cursed it, and what happened to it? It died. When it died, they came upon it and saw the fruit of what he said. He got what he said. How did he get what he said? Faith in God. Because that's what the disciples, they're like, whoa, how did this happen? And Jesus' first response was, he didn't say, oh, this is my method, this is my six-step plan, this is my hop, skip, jumping around the corner. No, he didn't say any of that. He said one thing. What? Have faith in God. Four words that'll change your life. Have faith in God. Let's turn to Matthew. Turn to Matthew chapter 7 real quick. This is just to piggyback a little bit of what he was saying here. Matthew chapter 7, verse 7 through 11. Jesus said, ask and it will be given to you. I don't think they have this up, so I'm just going to read it. Read along with me. Ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened unto you. But I love how he says, ask and what? It shall be given to you. Are you asking? Has it been given to you? And be honest, who has it been given to? Who hasn't it been given to? Raise your hand. If what you've asked for has not come yet, raise your hand. There we go. That's what I wanted to see. I was wanting to make sure we were on the right track tonight. We're good. I'm going to ask one more time. If what you're asking for, you have not seen it yet, or it has not come, raise your hand. There we go. I like that. I love honesty. Both hands, because that's, again, that's how we know we're in the right place. Praise the Lord. Okay. For everyone, verse 8, that asks what? Receives. Have you received? Raise your hand if you have not received. If you have not received, that means you were the one that raised your hand. I see some of you were like, what? If you raised your hand the first time, easy, just raise your hand again. Second time, okay. They've received other things. And that's good. Thank God for that. But I'm talking about the thing you're asking for. Did you receive it yet? Okay. Well, we're going to talk about that. All right. All right. Everyone that asketh, receiveth. Verse 9. What man is there of you? What man is there of you whom, if his son asks for bread, he will give him stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent? If you, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your Father in heaven give good things to them that ask him? Have you received what you have been asking God for. If you have, raise your hand. And it's okay to be honest. Praise God. I'm going to lift my hand because I have. Something. Okay, let's say some things is good, but not everything. Okay, that's when you can do like this. When you're like, okay, just do that little move. You got, you know, that's fine. Okay. But for the majority of people in this room, it looks like what we're asking for we have not gotten yet, correct? Okay, just want to make sure I'm in the right place. Praise the Lord. So how this message came about, I was, and I do want to take a second and thank Pastor David and Pastor Tracy for allowing us to host this conference here. Let's give God praise for Pastor David and Pastor Tracy. They're actually absent tonight. A member of the church who we know went home to be with the Lord, and so they're with the family to take care of them with the funeral and all that stuff. So we bless them in Jesus' name, but they'll be here tomorrow. I was listening to some of our confessions, and I'll never forget, I was sitting back there and just hearing people, period, and we're confessing. We're going to have this, lands and houses and money, $1 million checks and da-da-da-da this and da. How many have ever been in a service like that? Woo, electrifying. So much energy. Full of it. Yes, hype. He said full of hype. It's full of emotion. And we're getting so excited. And as I was standing there, I was confessing. I'm like, yes, Lord, yes. And that was a while ago, you know, and I've been to other services like that, not just here, other places, period. And as I was doing it, but this one particular time, the Lord opened my eyes sometime after we had said these things a couple of weeks, and he said, do a survey. I said, okay. He said, how many people are living what they said? And I said, no one, not even me. He said, there's a problem. I said, oh, I guess it is. If this scripture says, if it's not a lie, and I don't believe it's a lie, right? Ask and it will be what? It will be. It will be given to you. It will be given. And Jesus said again in Mark 11, whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them, and what? You will have them. Do we have it? Has anybody experienced anything that we've been confessing? All right, just want to make sure we're in the right place again. This, when I started meditating on this, and he was showing me this to prepare this for the school, he was showing me, I said, God, why is it that what Jesus said came to pass? And if we are made in his image and his likeness, when we say it, 90% of us don't get it yet. Isn't that an honest question? Yeah. Why is it? If Jesus was no different than us, because he came here as a man, he's just like you and I, and he said it and got it, why is it that we can't say it and get it? Why? Jesus said again, the key to all of this is what? Have faith in God. Always remember, four words that'll change your life. Now let's go to Romans 1. Romans chapter 1, verse 17. And you can put it up in. I'm just going to read from here. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, what? The just shall live by faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. Are you the just tonight? It's pretty weak. Are you the just tonight? There we go. That sounds like a child of God. That's what I thought. Everybody said yes, I hope. If you didn't, and we'll lead you to Jesus. But it says that the just shall what? Live by faith. It's a requirement for being just, is to live by faith. What does that mean? To live by faith. There's some other scriptures that accompany this. Write this down. Galatians chapter 3, verse 11. It says, now it is evident that no one is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. That was Galatians 3:11. It says, the righteous shall live by faith. Hebrews 10:38, it says, but my righteous ones, this is God talking, shall live by faith. My righteous ones. Is that you? Hello, righteous. Come on. Shall live by faith. And it says also, and if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. Oh, yeah. That's Hebrews 10:38. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 38. It says, my righteous one shall live by faith, and if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. Why does he say that? Because the scripture says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. So if you have no faith, you have officially not pleased him. It's official. Isn't that hard to hear sometimes? But it's the truth. Why? Because he's designed our life as the just or the righteous ones to do what? Live by faith. And Jesus said that's the key to getting everything that we say, is to have faith in God. So why aren't we getting what we say? I'm glad you asked. Again, it's evident that as we are saved people, followers of Christ, we are to be living by faith. So, again, the natural question becomes, what's faith? Right? What is faith? Any guesses? All right, good. Yeah, you can. Brother Hagin always says, or Brother Copeland always says, when people start mumbling, go, he always says, all right, now that's time to turn. Time to turn to it so you can look at it with your beady little eyes. Let's turn to Hebrews 11. Hebrews chapter 11, and we're going to park here for a little bit. And I'm taking this kind of slow because I want you guys to get it. I want us to get it. I want us to be able to say and possess. I said it earlier. How did I go from zero in the ministry account to going to seven nations around the world in 6 weeks, starting out with zero in my account? And was I here? Did I go to those places? Did Sean and I go to those places? How did we get what we said? Okay, Hebrews 11:1. And you can actually just like doing this, Anna, that's good. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. Let's break this apart. Now faith. Jesse DePlanta says, don't put faith in the future, what God's called now. Now faith. There's no future faith. It's faith for the what? Now. Now faith. That means now result. I'm scratching on some toes. But that's all right. Praise the Lord. Let's keep it up there. Now faith is what? The substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. I love this in the Amplified Bible. It says, now faith is the assurance, the confirmation, the actual title deed of the things we hope for. It is being the proof of things that we do not see. and the conviction of their reality. Faith comprehends as truth what cannot be experienced by the physical senses. Faith comprehends it as actual real substance. It's not actually waiting to come to pass. Faith is what? Now. So healing, in regards to faith in the Word of God concerning healing, it's not put off for when it manifests. Because faith says what? It's now. Don't put it off for when God does this. Because according to God, what happened? It's now. It's done. It's substance. I want you to take something in your hand. Feel it. Everybody feels something, right? That's substance. You can hold on to it. You can talk to it. You can move it. You can work it. Oh, I'm preaching to somebody. Oh, and it's myself. Thank you, Jesus. Faith is the substance. You can tangibly hold it, work it, feel it, say it, talk to it, look at it. Oh, faith. If faith was a cell phone, Lord have mercy, wouldn't that be a good message? I would have the best faith in the world because I am always on my phone doing business, contrary to popular belief. But it's the substance of that which is hoped for. It's the evidence of something that is not seen. And again, it's the title deed, the confirmation. Everybody knows what a title deed, right, is. It's the actual saying that it is what? Yours. It's not going to become yours. Ooh. It is yours. Right now. Don't put it off in the future. I'm taking my time with this on purpose. It's now. Everybody say, faith is now. Faith is now. Faith is now. And what else is faith? Substance. That's true. If it's not now, it's not faith. Thank you, Aunt Mary. Let's keep on reading. Where are we? Verse 2. For by it, by faith, the elders obtained a good testimony. Just keep going. By faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. So that, excuse me, the things which are seen, can I have a bottle of water? Somebody, Sean. So that the things which are seen, can you go back one in? I'm sorry, I was. So that the things which are seen were, next, thank you, not made of things which are what? That's an example of faith. When God, in Genesis chapter 1, created the earth, the scripture says what? The earth was without form and what? Void. It didn't have substance. Darkness was upon the face of the deep. The Spirit of God was what? Moving on the face of the water. A lot of times our situations don't look like they have substance. And God is moving. And there's people that preachers that'll come to you saying, but God is working on your behalf. God is going to do something. When is he going to do it? That'd be my question. If I'm sitting there getting ready to die and somebody said, well, God's getting ready to work for you, brother. When is he? If I got pain, I'll never forget. I'll share this tomorrow. I'll never forget when I had this toothache one time. It wasn't even a toothache. A piece of my tooth had chipped off, and I did not know that the nerve was exposed.
Yeah, if anybody's ever experienced that, they told me that they said that the pain, the quality of pain or the level of pain that I was experiencing, it went from my head down my spine, down my arms, and I'll never forget, I would be standing sometimes cooking, and it would just come on me in an instant, and I would literally, it was like someone was taking my nerve and doing like this all over my body, and I would sit there and just cry and scream and holler, and the first they said, you realize, they said, that's even worse than labor pain. And I said, well, I'm thankful I'm never a woman and never will be. As I said, I can't take that. No, thank you, Jesus. Oh, shaka baba, thank you, Lord. I'm getting my praise on. Just thinking about the goodness of the Lord and what he's done for me. My soul cries out. Hallelujah. Praise God. And all the men said amen. Praise God. But I'll never forget, I was sitting in the kitchen at one time when that happened. And if someone would have came to me and said, God's work on your behalf, brother, I'd have knocked him out. Has that ever happened to somebody when you at your down and out? You about to throw in the towel as well. God's working for you, brother. And you like, shut up. Get away from me. Can I get any amens from somebody? This is real church. Oh, this is school. So, you know, it's actually not church. So we can, you know, kind of go. I'm just your professor. So, you know, some professors are real cool. I'm your cool professor. I got my professor's jacket on tonight. Praise the Lord. Huh? Yes, he did heal me, and I'll talk about how that happened tomorrow. But again, just to make a point, I was looking for why isn't it happening now? If you said I can have what I say when I ask for it, why don't I have it right now? If faith is now. I didn't know some of this, though. But now I do, praise the Lord. And I learned it through that time, actually. But let's keep going. Where were we, Anna? Verse 3, I think, or 4, something like that. On 3. By faith, we understand that the worlds were framed, right? So that's where I was. God was moving on the face of the water, but nothing happened until what? God said, right? Some of y'all don't know what I'm talking about. Turn to Genesis chapter 1. That's all right. Some of y'all, as my old pastor used to say, or my founding pastor of my other church, she used to say, some of y'all looking at looking like a dog looking at a new bowl. Like you've never seen this before. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. I'm not even going to teach on that. I could share a little bit about that. But that in the Hebrew means completion. He created it perfectly. But something happened between verse 1 and 2. The earth became without form and void. Something happened. I believe it was when Satan fell and caused this earth to be without form and void. Because the scripture says in the Hebrew, it's tohu vabohu, which means utter chaos, destruction, the absence of light. Did God create the earth? Heavens and the earth with the absence of light? No, he didn't. So something happened between verse 1 and 2, which get some of my earlier teachings and you'll hear about that. But the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was moving upon the face of the waters. God was there in the midst of nothing. And God said, let there be light. And what happened? Was it in the future? It was then. It was now. So if I'm made in his image, according to Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, we're going to take our time with this. I'm almost done. I'm really slowing it down because I didn't realize I didn't have that much. So trying to fill up the tape that we have. Praise God. Nobody wants to listen to a 15-minute tape. Actually, some people would. Praise the Lord, but we're going to digest this. That'd be like eating an appetizer, and you're like, where's the steak? Where's the chicken? How many have ever been to a restaurant like that where they serve you these little teeny hors d'oeuvres? If you ever go to a fancy restaurant and they give you You pay $30 for a huge plate, and the food's like this big. You're like, where's the more? Where else is it? I'm still hungry. Feed me. Mm-hmm. I'm only saying that because I'm hungry now, but. I told somebody, I know I'm doing a whole bunch of rabbit jokes, but I told somebody, I went to go preach at a church in Missouri, and when I was preaching there, their pastor, many remember Pastor Kylie Oaks, she was here, Oaks Gatewood, she was here for our morality conference, and she's a fireball preacher, like on fire, and a preacher, like, and I walked up to them and I said, hey guys, your pastor is not here. I can promise you, I will not preach like that. I am not a preacher. I said, I'm a teacher. I said, but one thing I will make you do is laugh a lot. And then I said, part of it, I said, you've never probably seen somebody minister like this before in your church, and you've never seen somebody preach with a cup of coffee in their hand while they're teaching. And I said, but you will see that today. And there's a first time for everything. So they blessed me and excused me, and I drank my coffee and was happy. And they laughed a lot. So I'm grateful for laughter. Amen. Praise the Lord. It does good like a medicine, like the scripture says. But skip down to verse 26. It says, God said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. That means he made man a speaking spirit just like he is. That means when we say something, we should what? Have it. So when I say something and it's not happening, am I living the potential life that God has called me to live? Am I living like God? When I've been confessing and just saying and nothing's happening. Praise the Lord. Let's go back to Hebrews 3. Or where were we? Hebrews 11, excuse me. We were on verse 4, I believe. Thank you. Let's just keep reading. We can read it aloud, follow. Go back to the one verse. By faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying his gifts, and through it he, being dead, still speaks. Okay. By faith, Enoch was taken away so that he did not see death and was not found because God had taken him. For before he was taken, he had this testimony that he pleased God. That means he lived by faith. Next verse. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Keep going. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of righteousness, which is according to faith. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to the place which he would receive as an inheritance. And he went out not knowing where he was going. Next verse. By faith, he dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. Next verse. For he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker was God. I love this. We're going to pause right there. Go to Genesis chapter 12. I want to just look at that story. Genesis chapter 12. It says, now the Lord said unto Abraham, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show you. Now, I want you to mark something. Mark where it says, the Lord said unto Abraham. Underline that. We're going to notice a trend here, if you haven't already noticed it, through Hebrews 11. The Lord said unto Abraham, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house and unto a land which I will show thee, and I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing, and I will bless them that bless thee and curse those that curse thee, and in thee all and in thee shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, families of the earth be blessed. So Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him, and Abraham was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. He obeyed what God said. Go to Genesis 15. Genesis 15, verse 1. After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abraham. Again, this is what God said. The word of the Lord came unto Abraham in a vision. Fear not, Abraham, for I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. And Abraham said, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is Eleazar of Damascus? And Abraham said, behold, to me thou hast given me no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, this shall not be thine heir, but he that comes out of your own bowels shall be your heir. I'm going to preach about that tomorrow, how sometimes we manipulate what we want to come to pass, and it's not what God actually said. And God corrected him, and he said, this shall not be your heir, but he that shall come out of your own bowels shall be your heir. Verse 5, and he brought him forth, come on somebody, and said, look now toward heaven and tell the stars if thou be able to number them. And he said, so shall your seed be. And verse 6 says what? Abraham believed in the Lord, and it was accounted unto him for righteousness. Righteousness is God's way of doing and living and being right. That's what the Amplified says. But notice a trend here. Abraham believed what God said. And what happened? Faith came. And when faith came, we know, based on Hebrews 11, what? Possessed it. Go back to Hebrews chapter 11. Verse 11, through faith also Sarah herself, received strength to conceive the seed that God had just told Abraham about. That's the Joseph translation, by the way. Joseph Harris translation. Through faith, the actual translation is, Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she did what? Judged him faithful who had promised. The Amplified says, faith changed her physical. I guess you're getting it. Faith changed her physical body at an old age where she was not even producing. She hadn't been. She was barren, really. So she wasn't even producing anything. And faith changed her physical body. When did it change it? There we go. Right then and there, it changed it
Now, when God said it, she believed it. She didn't at first. The scripture says she laughed. Praise the Lord. But one day she believed it. And what happened? She had it. But there was something that was a prerequisite for her to have it. What's the key ingredient in all of this? Faith, but how did it come? By what? Say it out loud. By hearing what God said. I'm going to stick with my notes because I want to keep going off, but I'll go off tomorrow. Because I want you guys to get this tonight. I want us to get this. Faith changed her physical body to the point where she possessed a child. Verse 12, I think, is where we're at. Verse 12. Therefore, sprang there even one of one, and him as good as dead, so many as the stars of the sky in multitude, as the sand which is by the seashore, innumerable. Verse 13. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed them, woo, that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. Go to verse 15. Oh, no. Go to verse 33. We're going to skip some things in here. But you can read this. This is the faith, the Hall of Faith chapter. This is all about faith. It started with saying what faith is, right? And it shows what faith does. And what does faith do? It possesses, it's the substance of something that is hoped for, the evidence of things that are not seen, right? So let's go to verse 33. We're going to wrap this up. Verse 33. Are you guys enjoying this so far? Is this helping anybody? Okay. Verse 33, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions. Listen to this. Who through faith, okay, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in faith, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead raised to life. Come on, it's not impossible to raise the dead, contrary to popular belief. And others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. Let's keep on going down to verse 39. And others had trial mockings. Actually, let's just go to verse 39. And these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. God having provided some better things for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. Again, we see a pattern here. If you read through, just to save time, I didn't want to read through every account here, but there are several accounts of people who, through faith, received and possessed what God had said. And that's the difference. Again, where does faith come from? Let's go to Romans 10. We'll close with this. Romans 10. Where are you? Romans chapter 10. There we go. Let's read verse 14. And you can put it up on the screen, Anna. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? How shall they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Go on. And how shall they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those that preach the gospel of peace.
I confess that over my feet and others that I know that don't have beautiful feet. But I confess it by faith. Praise the Lord. Who bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? So then faith comes by, say it out loud, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Let's say that again and write it down if you have to. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Let's put this all together, okay? We started out with understanding that the just shall what? Live by faith, right? We found out that without faith, it's impossible to please God. We also found out that by faith, things happened. The world was framed, right? That means faith works. I might crush on some toes. I know some people that say this faith stuff don't work. No, you don't work. Because the last time I checked, I'm standing on a ground that faith created. And I'm a substance of what faith created. You're a substance of what faith created. So we found that out, that faith creates, faith possesses, it's a substance, right? Hebrews 11:1, faith is now faith, it's now, don't put it off for tomorrow when it's today, okay? Don't put it off in the future anymore. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, it's the evidence, the title deed of things not seen. So we found that out about faith. We now see that faith comes by what? Hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So we see that he speaks, and when God speaks, faith is created. Faith comes when we hear the word of God. And I'm going to talk about this tomorrow after Kelly ministers. It comes not just by the word of the Lord came unto me saying, son of man, prophesy. Oh, I'm a son of man. That means I'm going to prophesy. That says I'm a son of man, so therefore I'm going to prophesy. That's not how faith comes. By, oh, let me see if I can find that scripture to believe God for my Bentley. Let me see if I can find that scripture to believe God for that $1 million we've been confessing. Oh, I'm not even going to look up. Bless the Lord. Let me find that for that thing for that man I want. Let me find that. Oh, he gave me a Boaz. Praise the Lord. He gave her a Boaz. I'm going to get my Boaz. Praise the Lord. It says it right here. How many of you have ever done that before? Not that one specifically. But we just found something because we heard it. Or we knew that's what it said. But that's not how faith comes. Faith comes from the rhema word of God. What is God? The reason why faith is now, it's because God says it now. Somebody needs to write that down. It'll help you. What's God saying now about you? About your bill being paid? About the debt that you have? Woo! What's he saying? What did he say to us when we were believing God to go on our mission trip? First of all, he told us to take that time to go. He told us in January that we were going to be going in the summer. He said, go on a journey, told us the places to go. We marked it on the map. He said it. So when there was no money in the bank, I reminded him and said, no, wait a minute. You said to go to Europe at this time for 6 weeks back in January, and it's the week before I leave, and I don't have it, but you said
And how many of you know that when I worked, you said I got what he said? Oh, y'all ain't got it. I'm telling you that faith works every time when you work what he actually says. If you're not possessing something, he may not have said it. Ooh, let it mess up your theology. And I'm not saying that there's not a waiting. I didn't get the money in my hand the second that I said that reminder, but the money came into my hand. Actually, there were times when I did. I'll take that back. Thank you, Lord. There were times when working my time up to that, when I was like, okay, it's days, hours before we're getting ready to go. Actually, one time we were, while we were there, ran out of money. Oh, what's that like, being across the country and you ain't got no, in another country, broke? What'd that look like? But you know what? And I'll never forget, we were sitting at a great Italian restaurant. It's called Ristocchio's in Rome. If you ever go, they have the best pasta you've ever eaten in your life. Go there. It's amazing. And we were sitting out there dining al fresco. You'd think we got yachts and cars and everything. Just sitting there with nothing. Dirt. And I, when I realized it, I said, oh. I said, I looked at that account. I said, I think it may have even been negative. I said, oh. I said, okay. You said. Matter of fact, and he gave me the scripture to stand on then that whole time, and he told me to confess it until we left and even while we were gone, that give, you know, the scripture says give, and it shall be given to you, good measure, pressed down, shake it together, running over, that men pour into your bosom. I started to say it before all of this started happening, and I said, okay, Lord, that's the scripture you want me to say. So I started confessing, and I said, give, and it shall be given. He said, stop right there. I said, okay. He said, you have given, and now it's time for somebody to give to you. He said, don't even confess the rest. He said, say, I have given, and it is given unto me. I said, yes, Lord. Every time I confess it, somebody said, oh, I just want to bless you. $100, $1,000, $200, $150, $50, $25, every time. Oh, I just wanted to, I said, oh, okay, thank you, Lord. But how did that come? I worked what he said now. And what happened? I got what he said, not what I said, what he said. And the reason why it came to pass was because he needed me in this earth to manifest what he desired. Ooh. God's not just going to come manifest. He needs a man to do something through in order to manifest on this earth. A lot of times we're believing God and we're crying out for awakenings and things like that. We're supposed to pray about it. And I'm a big believer in that. We saw that in our last prayer meeting. How many were there last time we had a prayer meeting? Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo. Did we get in a high place in God, man? And for those of you that were there, I was reminded, don't forget we've got prayer assignments. I hope everybody's still praying. We had some major things come up that the Lord was showing us. And even that's a great example. When that happened, he started shifting us to pray. Not us. We didn't desire to. He put us to pray about the elections. And I said, yes, Lord. Okay, we're going to pray. And I had to get out of the place of, well, which side do I lean to? I stayed neutral in what he was saying. And he said, pray for Hillary Clinton. I said, okay, I will. I start praying, or several of us start praying, and we start seeing some things. And we say, oh, you know, when something like the light turns on, like, oh, so that's what's going on. That's who's involved. That's who's whispering in her ear. That's what's trying to come against what's going on. And he showed me, he said, do you realize that it has nothing to do with either candidate? It's about the spirit that's trying to work through either one. One may yield to me, and one is yielding to another. That's not him. And I'm not saying which one it is. But evidently, when I was praying for her, I saw some things that wasn't God. And I saw somebody actually whispering some things in her ear. And so we said, oh my goodness, it doesn't matter who wins. Let's pray they're yielded to God. Because that's how we're going to win. Who's yielded? I feel like this is a good spiritual mature group to talk about this. Vote for who God says. Don't vote based off of popular opinion and what he says will match this. Amen? What he says, the rhema word of God, spoken through the Spirit of God, into our hearts where faith is created, it will always match this. The scripture says that the word and the spirit agree. They go together. You don't have one without the other. Many of you have heard me testify a lot of times when Brother Hagin, I used to hear him teach this all the time, and he used an example. He said sometimes what people call God isn't. And he said all spiritual experiences aren't the Lord. And he said they should all match the word. And we know that the scripture says that the things of the spirit produce life and peace. Now, there are some things that I can't find scripture and verse for. But I know that it's God because it brings life and peace. Perfect example was the first time I ever met you, actually. I was at Global Awakening, and we were there for worship school or something. And that was my first time actually encountering the Holy Spirit. And I'll never forget, I was worshiping. They were up there worshiping, and I was standing up there and just loving on Jesus. And during that conference, I had never seen people shake before. Or like, you've seen people do like this rock, and I call them Holy Ghost crunches. I've never seen that before. And I said, God, and I'll never forget, while they were worshiping, I said, God, why do they do that? And instantly, I felt something tie around my feet, literally, and I felt it yank me. And I fell to my knees. And I said, I didn't do that. It yanked me again, and I fell to my side. I said, I know I didn't do that. And I said, what is going on with me? The most unusual thing happened. Best way I can describe it, this ball of light came and sat on my feet. And as it sat on my feet, the peace of God flooded my entire body. And I said, this is so cool. I did. I'll never forget that. I said, oh my gosh, this is so cool. I'll never forget, Brandy was with me too, Brandy and Antonio. We were just sitting there, and I said, this is so cool. And how many of you know, when I got up, I had Holy Ghost crunches for 3 days. I couldn't even walk. I was just like, oh, 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 what's going on with me? Whoa, ooh, ooh. I'd be asleep, and I'd feel myself go, them crunches, I said, Lord, they didn't work physically. I don't know what happened. But let's pray it manifests in the natural. I should have had a six-pack from that day. Praise God. But again, that experience matched the word because it brought life and peace. It didn't freak me out. Notice, even in Scripture, the Scripture says that when the angel appeared to certain people, they said, fear not. The things of God don't bring fear. It brings life and peace. And I'll never forget with this Brother Hagin story. I shared it before. He said he was walking through a hotel. And as he was walking, he saw this door open in this banquet hall. And everyone in there was levitating, flying in the air. He said, and he walked by. And everybody knows Brother Hagin. He walked by and he said, come down in the name of Jesus. And he said, every single one of them fell. Fell completely out of the sky. And he just kept on walking. How is he able to do that? Because he discerned it wasn't the word. It didn't line up with the word. And he knew that it didn't bring life and peace. And if it was the Lord, they wouldn't have never came down. And another time, another great supernatural experience, I just thought about this. Sister Billy Brim, who's another mentor of mine, she was in a meeting with Brother Hagin. And this is the most unusual thing. I think I've shared this before, too. She was in a meeting, and he got up to speak, and he said, "I'm going to talk to you about demons and principalities and darkness." He said, "If your eyes weren't holding you back, the very air about you is infested with demons and darkness." But he said, "Not to worry, there are twice as many angels." And Miss Billy said, at that, something picked him up, turned him on his side, and placed him on the floor. And she said, when it happened, the presence of God sat on them. So much so, she said, they couldn't move. She said, they were like stuck. And she said, somebody got up and started rebuking the devil. "I rebuke you, Satan." And she said, the person ended up shutting up. And she said, Brother Hagin, after a while, he crawled back up, walked back up to the podium. And he said, "Today I'm going to teach to you about angels or demons and such and such. If your eyes weren't beholden, the very air about you is infested with demons. But not to worry, there are twice as many angels." Something picked him up, turned him upside down, placed him on the ground, and the presence increased. She said, so much so they couldn't even blink their eyes. They were just like. She said, he got up again, did the same thing. Whoop. So he got up one more time. I guess it was the third time or fourth time. And she said, when he got up, he said, "Let's sing something victorious." She said, so somebody started jumping on the keys and started playing. And she said, she'd never seen this before. She said, people started getting up and spinning around like tops. You know, like a little top. She said they were spinning so fast you couldn't even see their face. She said, people were just, all these people were spinning. And she said, they laughed and couldn't stop laughing. And I believe she said, Brother Hagin walked over to her. He said, it's not going to be like you thought it was going to be. But it's going to be greater, and you're going to enjoy it. And she said, from that day, she's been forever changed because of that. And I'm personally praying and believing God that some of that will happen maybe this weekend. Hallelujah. There are things that God wants to manifest, and those manifestations of God are supposed to increase. It didn't pass away with Jesus. It didn't pass away when Brother Hagin went home to be with the Lord. That's for the here and now. Come on, y'all ain't excited about that. And it's not even for us. It's for the unbeliever. So that the scripture says in 1 Corinthians 14, if you don't believe me, it says that when that happens, they'll cry out to God. Ooh. People want to see God in these last days. And the way that they're going to see him is faith in God. How were the disciples, really an unbelieving generation, how were they able to see Jesus speaking to that fig tree and it dying and see what he said come to pass? That marked them forever. So who's waiting to be marked by your faith encounter? Who's waiting to turn to Jesus because of what? No, it's okay. Yes. Who's waiting to turn to Jesus because of your faith being worked to manifest God? This goes beyond cars and money and things like that. That's good. Believe me, anybody that doesn't believe God for money, you're missing it, because he sure give it to you, and he gives you a lot of it. Thank you, Jesus. I'll say this in closing. Many of you know my testimony. I just said earlier, you know, that some of you know that I'm a Food Network celebrity chef, but how that happened was I was in this meeting with Roy and Darlene, and most people know Roy and Darlene, they're elders in this church, and they're in Recife, Brazil right now with Teresa Shepherd, who's the prayer intercessor leader, head intercessor for our ministry. So we bless them in their absence, praise God, and just keep them in prayer. They're in Recife, Brazil, ministering to people. Matter of fact, tonight, right now, they're actually ministering to prostitutes that are on the street.
and loving on them and revealing Jesus. But I was in Roy and Darlene's meeting, and when I was there, they started prophesying over me. And Darlene said, she said, you know, God's going to do amazing things through you and just all this stuff with your ministry. She said, but I feel like God's saying, don't forget about your cooking. Don't forget about your cooking. You remember that? You were there. She said, don't forget about your cooking. I feel like God just, you know, and I still have the prophecy. She's like, just don't let it go. See what he wants to do. So I said, okay. So earlier that year, the Lord had told me in January of that year, he loves speaking to me in January for some reason. But in January, he told me, he said, this year, he said, you know, this year you're going to quit your job. I said, no, I'm not. How about that? I mean, I've ever told God that. I said, I don't think so. He said, I think he said, yes, you will. I said, no, I won't. And I fought with him for, you know, the scripture says, come, let us reason together. And normally it's because we don't want to reason with him. But bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Anybody ever reason with God about something? But amen. But I reasoned with him, and I finally yielded after 8 months. But in between that time, that was July, the end of July when that happened. And I'm just realizing this now. I forgot about this. End of July, that happened, and I quit in August, literally the next week. I flew out to Voice of the Apostles in Florida to do that conference, ministered together down there. And when I came back, or before I left, when I came back, actually, I hadn't even applied. I got an email from the Food Network, and they said, oh, we think you'd be a good fit for this show that we're doing. I said, okay, like, where did they get my email from? To this day, I don't know how. No clue. I quit that Friday, or I quit that weekend, or whatever it was, the week before, flew down to do that conference. I came back. I'll never forget, we were at another location at that time, but came for a Tuesday night Bible study. And when I was there, remember I said I'm always on my phone, but it was for business, praise the Lord. So I just happened to look down, and I saw that email, and I said, this is fake. And I showed it to Sean. I said, this looks fake. I don't think this is real. Showed it to Pastor David and Pastor Tracy. They said, well, try it and see, you know. So I send it in and send in everything they asked me for. And I just said, okay, God. And while I was doing that, I'll never forget this. After I asked Pastor David and Pastor Tracy about it, I said, Lord, I don't know if I should do this. And that word that Darlene prophesied came up in my heart. And she just, all I heard was, just don't forget about your cooking. And I said, okay, all right, Lord, I'll do it. That's what I feel like you're saying. That's what I heard, so I'll do it. So I apply. 2 hours after I sent it, they email me. You're exactly what we're looking for. Can you do this? I said, okay. So then comes the real test. If you've ever auditioned for a major network, you have to go through months and months and months of auditioning. So we went to New York and all this stuff, and it was a mess. I had to, like, present them a dish and all this stuff. They didn't have anything to heat it up. And I had some, don't tell anybody this, even though this is live, but they asked for a dish that you create a dish, and I didn't have time. Many of you know my schedule. I didn't have time at that time to cook anything, so I took some gumbo that I had made maybe a month or two before. It was in the freezer. It was in the freezer. And I said, Lord, this is going to have to work. And I even think he showed it to me. He said, use that gumbo. I said, oh, Lord. So I get up there and I said, okay, I'm going to find a Whole Foods that's down the street from the audition place. And this was so cool. They had said, you don't even have to come for a public audition. We'll have a private audition for you. I said, praise the Lord. So I get up there. The Whole Foods does not have a microwave. And gold gumbo is disgusting. Well, maybe for some people. I like my food hot, but it probably may have been good. I don't know. So it had been sitting in that container. Thank God it was a little bit defrosted, you know, but it was still a little chilly. And they said, you won't be able to heat this up. If it's a hot thing, you got to bring it hot and all this stuff. So I'm already done. I said, I'm not going to win this. I'm not going to such and such and all this stuff. Actually, and you know, I forgot to mention so many confirmations from what God said about this whole experience. Before I went to New York, I was picking up a friend of mine who was ministering here, at the church, and Roy was with me, Darlene's husband. And I'm pumping gas before we go to the airport to pick up my friend, and he looks at me and he says, "So Joseph, tell me about this competition, this cooking competition I see you winning, and how much money it is." And I said, "Oh, it's $50,000 and such and such." I looked at him, I said, "I never told you I was auditioning for a TV show or whatever." He said, "Oh, I know you didn't." He said, "But the Lord just showed me that you're going to go on a competition and you're going to win $50,000. And I said, "Oh, praise the Lord." I said, "Okay." So you know sometimes when the Lord didn't really show you at first. I mean, he's told you, but you didn't grasp it the first time. How many know it's better to obey and listen the first time? But that was just another confirmation because I was, you know, fighting with the Lord still and broke, didn't have no money or anything. And so that happened. Went to New York, passed with flying colors. I thought I was going to lose and stuff. They called me. They're like, "Great, you passed. You're in the final casting review. We're going to just look at a couple things." And then months later, a couple weeks later, they called me and they offered me the role to be a part of the cast. And to God be the glory for that. And when they offered it to me, the woman said, she said, "Do not tell anyone this." She said, "I'm the executive producer of the show." And she said, "I fought for you to be on this show." She said, "Most people said you were too nice." She said, "And they don't really like that on TV." She said, "But then the other side was people," and I knew what it was. She said, "They said there's something different about him. There's this light coming out of him." And she said, "I knew what it was because I'm a pastor's kid." And she said, "So I was able to pick up on it." Talking about being at the right place at the right time and being obedient to the Lord and seeing all this, he was working all things together for my good, but I had to step out, and I'll talk about this tomorrow. I had to step out and be obedient to what he said, to possess what he said. I didn't just step out on my own and say, "Oh, I'm going to go be famous. I'm going to go be on TV. I'm going to go win me $50,000. I'm going to go get on American Idol so that I can sing and everybody going to know me." People would ask me that all the time, and I'd say, "Well, the Lord didn't tell me to do it." "Well, he might tell you when you get there." No, he won't. Anyway, so I got on the show, of course, and I almost quit 3 times during the whole taping process because it was just too hard. I am the epitome of a home cook. I cook meatloaf and fried chicken and all that good stuff. And they were like, "You know, we want you to cook exotic and 5-star restaurant stuff." And I'm like, "Oh, Lord." And all that time, every time I got ready to quit, that prophecy from Roy, "You know you're going to win. I see you winning such and such." And I'm like, "Oh, okay, God, yes, yes." And each time, and they knew me on set, I'd say, "Can I go pray? Can you excuse me real quick?" Then, "Oh, yeah, he's going to go pray." They'd let me go pray and all that. I got to pray for people when I got, and I even said, one of my best friends, Cassie, in California, we were talking the night before I left, and she said, "Who do you think your team you're going to be on?" I'm like, "I don't know, but the only person I would not want to be on is Bobby Flay." I said, "Oh, my gosh, I would hate to be on his team. I'd be so scared." How many know he picked me to be on his team? And for that, I was grateful. I said, "Oh, yeah, call my name, brother." But I got to, many people didn't know this, but I got to even minister to him and just love on him through that time. And he said, "You're different." To know him is to love him. If you don't know him, it might be another story. I'll say that much. But he's just, it's more of a defense mechanism. He doesn't allow you to get to know him because he's probably been hurt a lot and abused a lot. Remember I was talking about fame earlier? People will use you and it's terrible, but he keeps his protectors up. But through the grace of God, he let it down a little bit for me. And he looked at me, I wrote him a note. It was his birthday. And I said, "What do you get a man that has everything?" And I wrote him a note, and I just said, he doesn't have a handwritten note. And I guess it was the Lord. And I just told him, you know, how much I appreciated him and all this stuff. And just told him that I believe that God still had a plan for him, for his life. And told him that Jesus loved him and that I was praying for him and all of this stuff. And little did I know what he was actually going through at that time. You know, he was in the middle of a big public affair right after the show, right before the show premiered. But all of that was going on while we were filming, and I had no idea. And I just ministered to him, and he came to me when we were on set one day, and he just looked at me. He said, "I wanted to thank you for your note." And he was serious, I could tell. He said, "But I just want to tell you," he said, "you're different." He said, "You're really different." He said, "You're not like anyone else I've ever met." And he said, "And I don't know what it is," he said, "but there's something different about you, and I like it." And how many of you know that that was the Lord? But, and all that to say, and you thank God I won, and everybody knows that, I won that $50,000 and all of that. And I possessed what Roy prophesied, that faith. But every time that I wanted to quit, that faith would come back up in my heart and speak to me. And I'm going to talk about that tomorrow, how faith speaks and remind you of what God says until you possess it. That's the waiting. But you fight the good fight of faith. That's tomorrow. But anyway, when that happened, and after it was all over, I realized, I said, "God, this is amazing." I just couldn't believe it. And he showed me, he said, he was just showing me, and I even see it now. If I had not heard in January to quit my job, I would have never been in the right place at the right time to hear the word of the Lord from Roy and Darlene to quit, to pursue the cooking, quit the week after they said that, come back and find that email, apply for it based off of the word of faith that came into my heart, months later possessed it and possessed $50,000. Never would have happened if I never heard it in January. So I'm going to ask you again, what has God said? What is he saying now? Tomorrow, we would do that tomorrow, Lord. Yeah, go ahead and stand at your feet, guys. Tomorrow, I want you guys, remember I said, for those of you that weren't here, I had said on Sunday, I felt like the Lord had put it in my heart to have everyone write on a piece of paper what they're believing God for, or things that you're believing God for. And I want you guys to still do that, okay? We're going to take care of that tomorrow. I'm going to do a little exercise and an experiment. Please do that. If everyone, first of all, did you guys enjoy it tonight? Did you get a little something? Praise the Lord. Thank you. And we're going to close, I want to, yes, dear. Sure. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, go ahead. Oh, microphone, hold on. It's important to be recorded. This is Wanda, everybody. Hey, Wanda. Oops. Hold on, there we go.
Hi, I'm Wanda, and I love to write, especially to Jesus. And
she does.
Yeah. And so it really works. I write down several times, all the time, what I'm expecting from God, and he totally answers it. Like, and you can go back and see where, and see the date,
yeah,
and all kinds of stuff. So I really encourage y'all to do that and be specific what you are expecting God, because he is your daddy, and he wants you to do that. Like,
yeah,
we're his kids. We can come to him like that. We're spoiled in that way.
Yeah.
You know, he may discipline us, but he wants to lavish us with his gifts.
He
wants that. And that's faith, knowing that your daddy got this. Like, I'm praying for a car. I'm praying for a vehicle to clean. I want to clean for the nations. I want to clean and give the money to the for missions. That's what I'm desiring to do. So I need a license. I need a car. I need, all that for that. So, and I'm trusting God he will do that, because I'm doing it for the Lord.
Yeah.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Stand here for a second. I'm going to pray over you. I'm going to say this, and then I'll pray over you. Just because tonight I don't feel led to, we'll see. I don't know what God wants to do right now. But I will say this, just come back tomorrow morning. Kelly will be in the pulpit again tonight. She has to be excused. She's needed to prepare and needed the rest. So she will be ministering all day tomorrow at 10 a.m. and as well at 7 p.m. Tomorrow night we are going to have a healing service. Praise the Lord. So she and I are going to, I saw it in my spirit, we'll just be working the gifts of the Spirit, and we'll lay hands on people and pray. And she's prepared. She told me, she said, I'm ready. We'll do whatever needs to be done. So if you're believing God for specific things in your body, I saw earlier in my spirit too as well for some people who you know or maybe yourself struggling with some sort of substance abuse, some sort of, I even see it now like a torment an addiction concerning, like prescription pills, things, aids to help you go to sleep at night. I see in my heart just prescription medication. And if, I'm not telling you to not take it, don't put words in my mouth, but tomorrow we're going to believe God. I feel like there's some people that will be here tomorrow that are believing to stop that, because that's not God's perfect will for you. He desires to make you whole, spirit, soul, and body. And does Jesus take prescription medication? Can't find it. So do you have to? There we go. Thank you. I knew I'd get an agreement. Some people may not agree with that. Like I said, I'm not telling you to not take it. I'm saying there's a better way. Live completely free. Don't be dependent upon anybody but the Lord. So I saw that in my spirit, and I believe that Kelly, you know, has a word in her heart. She's so excited about this. She's been talking about it for a long time coming here, and she's heard a lot about this house and learned her. You know, her and her family and I are great friends, so we've shared a lot about this, and she's really excited to be here tomorrow. So please come. Please bring people. I would love for this place to be filled. We want to be a blessing to her, and Micah's going to be leading worship. Tomorrow morning is going to be an intimacy set. If you like soaking and just laying before God, and you don't want to miss that. I soak to her music all of the time. But please come back tomorrow at 10 a.m. Doors open at 9. And tomorrow night at 7 p.m., doors open at 6. Also as well, I did forget this. Please visit our product table. Our vendors are, well, we have some more tomorrow, but we do have a dear sister, Miss Jennifer, who is believing God to go on a missions trip to Uganda. You are leaving October the 21st? 27th, thank you. And there's information in this booth right here about the missions trip, how much they're believing God for, and all of that good stuff. So please go in there and visit. If you're able to sow, please sow into her ministry. If not anything, please just take a pamphlet and pray for her. If anything, we need prayers, especially when you're out on the mission field. And even at our last trip, we could feel the prayers of people. So let's just lift up our hands and thank the Lord for what is being done tonight. Billy, if you can take this away. Thank you, Lord. His spirit's in here. And Wanda, I can stand behind her, Sean. Wanda, it caught my ear, and I believe it was the Lord just put attention on my ear when you said that your desire is to clean nations, you said, right? Clean for the nations. But I feel impressed with the Lord to tell you that you not only will clean for them, but you will clean with them. And God's going to use you to do the actual physical cleaning. Not cleaning. I see you because you're so much a servant. This woman, bless her heart, she even wrote me yesterday. She said, I guess you didn't know it was a free conference. She said, I'll clean the church to come to the conference if you'll allow me. I said, Wanda, it's a free conference. You don't have to do that. Just come, you know. But I understood her heart and wanted to even bless her for that. But I feel like that, and I've seen this transformation that you've had over the last couple of months, and I know it's the Lord, but I saw specifically, I could see you not just cleaning the physical, but I could see God using you to clean the spiritual. And I even see at times God using your tongue and changing your dialect supernaturally. Like you'll just begin to open up your mouth. And I specifically see African countries. I see Swahili and at times your foot in Nigeria and other places. I even see Peru and in some places in Canada too as well. But
I just feel like, and I just see God using you. He's going to use your mouth. You just lift up your hands. Father, so I just anoint it. Don't cover your mouth ever again. Everybody stay engaged. Don't take your eyes off the Lord as he's here. Thank you, Father. Yeah. Oh, yeah. There he is. Hallelujah. And I speak. Yeah. There it is. The identity. Thank you, Father. Even as a prophet of God, I unlock the spoken word in Wanda's mouth. And he's preparing you now. So get ready. Pack your bags, get ready to go. Sometimes it'll even be supernatural. He'll take you places while you're sleeping. I see you lying on your bed and being transported and translated and going all over the world. And it's because he's going to trust what's going to come out of your mouth. And that's why it's been hard and the attack's been hard on your mouth, because God has a plan for your mouth. What he wants to do through what you're saying. So, Lord, I just seal that by faith tonight. Yep. And I call forth the gift. There it is. Increase. Come now. Come now. Fill her. Fill. Yep. There it is. Yep. Let it fill. I just see it's like bubbles. Let them fill your mouth. Yeah. Fill. There it is. Whoa. More God, more. Yeah. Give God praise, guys. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Do you have anything? No? Sure. Just honor the Lord. Just pray in the spirit for a minute. Ramasonda la rabakayete. Anda la baha sonda ebrasta, amoso onde le brasta, kendo omba aste, amboro sonde le frahasta, I kanamanya ndola vaste inde le brenda hadla, anda la masonda. What's your name, sir? Sean? Okay, masinda lambroste. Father, I thank you for the demonstration and the working of signs and wonders and miracles. There it is. Access it now. We access that by faith. I speak to the gift of God inside of you, and I say, come forth. Release in Jesus' name. The gift of God. Hallelujah. Inside. I feel like God's passing out gifts. I see him. Yeah. Is that right, Lord? Yes. I kept hearing instructions. And I thought it was instructions for the weekend or something. That's why I was asking you, did you have anything? But I see there's specific instructions. So that's not to say that, you know, he'll use me or someone else to prophesy to you. But just press into the Lord right now. Just go back into that place. I can feel it too as well. Something like when you're shifting, just stay engaged, stay in God. He has some instructions that he wants to download to you tonight. Hallelujah. Even concerning faith. The word of wisdom, the wisdom of God. The scripture says to let us, that the wisdom of God, he doesn't withhold it. He doesn't hold it back, that he is always willing to give us his wisdom. So, Lord, tonight we ask for your wisdom. We ask for the wisdom of God. Go ahead and just tell him that tonight. I ask for the wisdom of God. I ask for the wisdom of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mangarodo bosheketa la bahasata. Name barasunda la lemikita la makaye. Sorenedia bahashanda. Let's just take this last few minutes just to worship the Lord. Hallelujah. You can come to the front and worship or lay down or whatever. We're going to officially close the meeting. Come back tomorrow at 10 a.m. To hear Kelly and be blessed, but let's just worship Jesus for a little bit longer. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.